in Stephenville, Texas, just a few years ago, where there was a mile-wide ship that parked over in Stephenville. And you just saw everything that's been going on around the world. And it's increasing. Stuff is real. But, thank God, Scriptures say, fear not, for God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. How many Christians do you know are walking in power? Now, I'm preaching to myself. All right? We've got to understand this power stuff. Everybody says God is in control. I understand that. God created the universe. Of course he's in control. However, the same God has bound himself by his word. What did he say? Go, you human beings, go have dominion on the planet. Dominion means have control. God bound himself by his own word that everything that takes place on this planet is going to be done by man. But he says, I'll help you. Go all the way back to the Torah. Moses is standing there. 2 million Jews. Pharaoh's army coming in the back. Ocean in front. God, what do we do? What does God say? What are you looking at me for? You got the rod, you do it. That's my paraphrase. God told Moses to do it. Moses raises a stick. God worked through him. Ocean split. They go through. Same thing happens all through the Scriptures. That's why God had to come to earth as a man in the first place. Because he said everything that's going to happen here is going to happen through man. So when we're all like, God's in control, he's saying, yeah, but I put the control in you. You guys got to do stuff. I'll do it through you, but on earth it's got to happen through you guys. These things have I spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. Not freaking out. Don't go nuts. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, whoever them they are. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world or in the sky, I would submit. I've used the word Yeshua quite a few times, and I've already said it before. I've become very fond of that name. You know, like I said, I do believe there's power in the name of Jesus. I got saved in the name of Jesus. I've led people to Christ in the name of Jesus. I've seen people set free, healed, and delivered in the name of Jesus. But the name Yeshua is extraordinary. In Hebrew, it means salvation. But every Hebrew letter has multiple meanings. There's a Hebrew idiom that says every Hebrew letter has seven meanings and every word has 70. And the reason they say that is because with the seven meanings for each letter, whenever you take letters and make words, you can see how each word can have a multitude of meanings based on the letters that comprise the word. So if you look at this amazing word, salvation, Yeshua, the name of our Savior in Hebrew, reading from right to left, it means the hand that destroys the establishment of the eye. Our buddy Nimrod. That we talked about in the previous session. He is the one that destroys the eye on the back of your dollar bill and everything associated with it. Here's something really cool. Remember we talked about Mount Hermon, where it was located? This is the mountain range right here. This is a very interesting conversation took place at the base of Mount Hermon right here. Caesarea Philippi. This is where at the end of Jesus' ministry, he took his disciples and he says, who do men say that I am? That was a strategic location because right there is the altar of the Greek god Pan. Pan was the Greek god of shepherds. So the good shepherd stood in front of the Greek god of shepherds and said, hey, who do people say that I am? Oh, some say Elijah, some say Jeremiah. No, Peter understood. Just off to the right of that location where Pan was is a foothill. And at the top of this foothill is the fortress of Nimrod. The first Antichrist to try to create a one-world system without God. In fact, his desire was to kill God. If you're looking at the altar of Pan, Nimrod's fortresses to the right, to the left, is this location right here, which is the gates of Hades. He was standing right next to the gates of Hades when he said, the gates of Hades will not prevail. He was standing right next to it. You can go there today. I've always maintained Hades is not just the place, it's the brother of Zeus. 6 days later, Scripture says that Yeshua took Peter, James, and John to the top of a high mountain. Well, Mount Hermon is by far the highest mountain in the region. They're in the area anyway, so most scholars believe, as I do, that is the location of the Mountain of Transfiguration. where today there is a UN radar outpost sitting on top of it. Right across from a cross that people have set up as the location believed to be where the Mountain of Transfiguration took place. What's the UN doing with a UN radar outpost on top of the spot where the fallen angels landed? I understand the strategic location, Syria and all of that, I get it. But from that location, they can look right down into the valley to the very location where the 200 watchers came in the days of Noah, or the days of Jared, I should say, right? Pre-flood world, Genesis chapter 6. Yeshua could look down, and the UN can look down there today. Why did he bring his disciples there to ask that question? I could never understand that, because he gets so excited when Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." You read Yeshua's response, right? He gets so excited. I'm like, why is he so excited about that? When the day he was born, angels declared he was the Son of God, right? As he got older, everybody told him he was the Son of God. He picks Nathanael to be a disciple, and he says, "You are the Son of God." He says, "Why? Because I saw you under the fig tree? You're going to see greater things than that." Every time the demons possessed people saw him, they threw themselves on the ground and cried out, "You are the Son of God," and he told them to be quiet. So from the day he was born and all through his life and all through his ministry, people told him he was the Son of God. So what's the big deal when Peter says it at the end of his ministry? His destination was Jerusalem. He takes a massive detour and goes all the way up to the top of Israel, to the base of Mount Hermon in southern Lebanon, northern Israel, parks in front of the Greek god of shepherds. Says, "Who do men say that I am? Some say Jeremiah, some say Elijah, some say one of the prophets." Oh, if I was shooting the scene as a filmmaker, I would see it like this, where Peter is looking at Yeshua and his back is to the altar, and it's called a rack focus. Yeshua goes out of focus, Pan comes in focus. This is Peter's point of view. Pan goes out of focus, Yeshua comes back in focus, and Peter goes, "Oh, I get it." See, he understood the book of Enoch. That's clear. We saw that in the other scriptures, right? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God, not the Son of Zeus. Oh, yeah, that's right, Peter. And upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. Not these rocks behind me. That was an altar that looked very similar to Petra, like a city in the rock. It was a big embedded, you know, place in the rock for Pan. If I could put it in modern terms, I would use the movie Rocky. Rocky is not a movie, a series, is, you know, six movies. It's not about boxing. Yeah, it's got boxing on there, but it's an allegory. As a filmmaker, as a writer, I know nothing makes it onto the movie screen without a lot of preparation, a lot of meetings, a lot of deliberation. Everything is very intentional, everything that ends up on the screen. First thing that comes up on the screen, you fade up from black, is a picture of Jesus. Very first shot. Rocky 1. The camera pulls back, and you see Rocky fighting Spider Rico. Notice what it says behind him. Resurrection. Right? Rocky's fighting Spider Rico. Rocky's a nobody at this point. Rocky, the rock, right? He's fighting a nobody. But he's given the opportunity of a lifetime. He's given the opportunity to fight Apollo Creed, the heavyweight champion of the world. Who's Apollo? Apollo is Nimrod. What's Creed? Creed is the belief system of a people group. Rocky, the rock, is given the opportunity to go against Apollo Creed, the heavyweight champion of the world, the god of this world, right? What does he do before the big fight? He walks into the ring. He surveys the ring. What does he see when he's there? He sees this picture of a giant. Apollo. He goes home, and he has his Garden of Gethsemane experience of doubt, maybe a little fear. Talks with Adrian. He gets a renewed strength, and he says, "I don't care if I beat him. I just want to go the distance with Creed." Nobody has ever gone the distance with Creed. What that meant was nobody's taken, gone head to toe with the world heavyweight champion and stood for 15 rounds. That was his ambition. He went into the ring, took the beating of his life from the world heavyweight champion. For 15 rounds, Apollo Creed unleashed everything he had on him. But at the end of 15 rounds, Rocky was still standing. Shocked the world. Everybody freaked out. The announcers are going, "Rocky, what was going through your mind? Rocky, what were you thinking?" And as they're saying that, the camera cuts to Adrian coming in through the back door making her way, and the only thing on his mind is he kept saying, Adrian! He kept calling out for his future bride. Adrian came running. Polly let her in under the ropes. She comes into the ring. The last line in the movie, she says, I love you. He says, I love you. I cry when I watch Rocky movies. Cause, right? Because I see this stuff. Mainly because of spending the time that I had in Caesarea Philippi, and I understood what Peter, I think, picked up. It's a pretty huge revelation. I can use that as a little allegory, as a word picture, to show you what I believe Yeshua was doing when he went to Caesarea Philippi. And oh, by the way, Rocky II, the Rock, goes back into the ring, right? First he gets married, and then he beats him. What's coming up next, right? From that location, Yeshua could look down to the gates of Hades, and the altar of Pan, you know, the mountain of transfiguration, where if they use the Rocky analogy, Mickey and Polly showed up to give him a pep talk. Moses and Elijah, right? You look down to the fortress of Nimrod. It says that from that point on, after he left that, from that experience right there, it says he went preaching about his death, burial, and resurrection. And he headed straight from there to Jerusalem, where he would go 15 rounds with the devil, so to speak, and still be standing when it was over. That's why he took him to Caesarea Philippi. Because that location, remember the first prophecy in the Bible, the seed of Eve will crush the devil's head. So the attempt was made on Mount Hermon. So right before the big fight, Yeshua went to the very spot where that plan was hatched to try to prevent him from existing in the first place. He looked down and said, yeah, I got your number, Nimrod. Pan. All right, you just wait. And what's amazing is it says that he first went down, where did he go after he died? Remember? Went down into the depths of Hades. And he preached to those in prison. Horrible translation. Caruso. He heralded in victory. Tartarus to the prison of the gods. He went down there and said, you tried to stop me. I won. I'm taking the keys. And oh, by the way, I'll be back and Hank, it'll be good for you. Rob paraphrase. That's what our Savior did. That excites me, man. That just charges me up. And that explains the question, who do you say that am? I believe that this revelation is something we need to get for such a time as this. What did he say? Upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. The gates of Hades. What's a gate? Something that something goes in and out of. Something's coming back through the gates of Hades. What's the fourth horse? The fourth horseman of the apocalypse. Gray horse, pale horse. Its rider is death. What follows him? Hades. What does that mean? That means Tartarus is going to be opened up in the last days. That's Joel chapter 2. The locusts of Joel chapter 2. There's a whole bunch of people in the body of Christ out there thinking that they, and Sarah Palin's one of them, thinking that they are the Joel 2 army. I'm like, guys, read Joel chapter 2. That is not a description of believers. That is a description of the Nephilim army. It's